Good evening everyone. Today we will continue with the UV visible spectrophotometry. Okay. I will start with this how to measure the samples or analyze the samples using the UV visible spectrophotometer. Okay. We started yesterday, but somehow there was an disruption in the internet connection, so I could not complete it. So I will start that part from the beginning. Okay. So as I was telling you yesterday, suppose I give you an analyte A. Okay. And I ask you to find out the analyte A in a solution. Okay. I will tell you that the solution of analyte A will be made in, say, any solvent. Say, in this case, we take water. Okay. Now, I want you to find out the solution, the concentration of the analyte A in the solution in which I have, which I have given to you. Okay. Now, how to find out that the concentration of the analyte A in the solution? The first and the foremost thing is that I do not know any UV visible absorption characteristics of the analyte. Okay. So since I do not know this absorption characteristics of the analyte A, what I need to do? First, I need to make a solution of A. And I told you the test what I will be giving, it will be a solution of A in water. So I have to make a solution of A in water. Okay. Now once I have made the solution in water, I have to go for UV visible spectrum scanning. Okay. So in the spectrum scanning, what it will do? It will find out at each of the wavelength what is the absorption properties. Okay. Okay. So I will find out the spectrum of the solution of the analyte A when I dissolve in water. Okay. So what will happen now? From here, I will find out the region where I am getting the maximum absorption. And that, suppose this peak where I have shown this arrow, this peak is the maximum absorption peak, then I can label it as lambda max of the analyte A when I dissolve the analyte A in water. Okay, so this is my lambda max. That means at lambda max there is the highest absorption by analyte A. Okay, when I dissolve the analyte A in water, right? Now, while measuring the spectrum, you have to be very careful that the maximum absorption what you get, it is in between 0 and 0.8. Okay, in many spectrophotometer, you will find that it is giving you the absorption measurement range of 0 to 3. In some you may find even up to 4. Okay, but though technically that is possible, I personally will always advise you to work in the range of 0 to 0.8. Okay. Now, why this is so? Okay. Yeah, first thing, what if I get more than say 0.8, say 1.2, if I get the maximum absorption is 1.2, so what should I do? Okay, then whatever the solution you have got, you have to dilute the solution in such a way that the absorption lies in the range of 0 to 0.8. Okay, you have to do this task. Okay, once you have done this task, then you will find that you have calculated or you have found out the lambda max of the analyte when it is being solubilized in solution A. Okay, the next step is that after the identification of the lambda max, the next step is the preparation of a standard curve. Okay, the preparation of the standard curve. So in the standard curve, what should be the x-axis? X-axis is the concentration. Okay, so it is usually mg per ml or microgram per ml. Okay, so you will be having say C1, C2, C3, C4, and then in the y-axis you will be having the absorption, right? Now what you will have to prepare a known concentration or a set of known concentration of the analyte A solution in water. So C1, C2, C3, C4, and they are in the increasing, as we move from C1 to C4, they are increasing in a linear way. Usually what it is done, say for example, we can make 100 mg per 100 ml of Stock solution. That means 1 mg per ml of Stock solution we make, and then we dilute this solution accordingly. Okay, and how the dilution is made, or the how you will find out the concentration of the dilution, say you are taking 1 ml of this one multiplied by 1 mg per ml and this is you have taken 1 ml of this one, and this would be equal to concentration into what would be the final volume. Say you have added, you have taken 1 ml of this analyte Stock solution and you have added another 9 ml of water, then it would become 10 ml. The final, this thing will be 10 ml. So this gets cancels out and your concentration, it becomes, say, this 0.1 mg per ml. Okay. So in this way, you can add up different volumes of this Stock solution, and you add up different amount of volumes so as to make the final volume as 10 ml. You can also make it to 20 ml. It all depends on you. Okay. So more the water you add, the lower will be the concentration. Okay. So in this way, you can find out the you can make a series of known standard solutions. Okay, now once you have made the known standard solutions, you have to find out the absorbance of those. So what you will get, you will be getting some discrete points in the curve. Okay. Now you have to remember one thing, is that you have to fit this curve, okay? Oh, sorry. Okay, you have to fit this curve, and you can do the fitting in any of the Excel software, and you get the equation, and you will get it y equals to mx plus c. But while you are fitting, you have to see that at zero concentration your absorbance is zero. Okay, so while you will be fitting, there is a checkbox that set intercept at zero. Okay, so why this is necessary, this step is necessary. I have seen many student, they do the mistake over here. So why that is important? This is important because if you do not set the intercept as zero, then what will happen? Say for example, you may get something like this, a line. So it would say that when there is no analyte into the solution, then also the normal solvent, it is absorbing some radiations, okay, which is not desirable, which is not desirable. Okay, we do not want to want the solvent to have some absorptivity. So you would say, sir, it is not possible for that. Yes, you are correct that it is not possible that, you know, we control the absorption of some radiation by the solvent. But to avoid that, what we do is that before we operate the UV visible spectrophotometer, we do zero balancing. That means in the split beam, we keep a reference as the solvent. Sorry, it's not there. Yeah. So if we are taking the zero reference, this thing, so what we do is that in the reference, we put the solvent, and also in the sample also, we put the same solvent, and then we do zero balancing or baseline correction. So what it does is that when we talk about two photodetectors, under ideal conditions, both the photodetectors are also having similar same characteristics, but ideally it is not present. Then when we are talking about quartz cuvette, both the quartz cuvette, they are also having ideally they will also be having same absorption characteristics, but under ideal, under this practical condition, it might not be possible. Okay, then one of the cuvette may be slightly more dirtier than the other, then that would also give you some absorption. So under practical consideration, there are certain problems. So due to this reason, what we do zero balancing, or also we call it this baseline correction. So we measure the baseline, okay, and then we put it as zero. So what does the system does? Whatever the absorption and all these things are there, it will record it in its memory. Okay, then you start measuring the concentration of your analyte solutions of known concentration. Okay, so then you will be getting this, and when you will be fitting it to y equal to mx plus c, and you will be setting the intercept to zero, then this equation, it would become in the form of y equal to mx, and then at zero concentration where there is only water, in this case only water, then there will be no absorption. Okay, that means everything has been taken care of. I have seen many students, they do not do this and they take this C component also, which is incorrect. So please be remembered, please remember this. Okay, now once you have got this equation, so you have seen in x-axis what we are having. In the x-axis we are having concentration and in the y-axis we are having absorbance. Okay, we have got a relationship now. Now I have started over here. I said I gave you a solution of analyte A to you. Now you test this solution. Okay, now you test this solution and you find out the absorption. Now once you have found out the absorption, then you go to this equation and then you can calculate the concentration from there. And another important thing, you have to see that all these concentrations, they are having absorption which is less than 0.8. Now you would ask, sir, why below 0.8? Most of the semiconductor devices, they are not linear sensors. Okay, so they are non-linear sensors. Okay, so if you come to the lab and we will do the experiment over here also, you will find suppose when you are making this standard curve, up to 0.8 there is a linear relationship between the concentration and the absorption, and beyond this there is slight deviation in your absorbance, okay, which you do not want, because if there is any slight deviation, if there is a non-linearity over here, then what will happen is that while you will be measuring this concentration and all these things, you will be incorporating measurement errors. Are you getting my point? You will be incorporating some measurement errors. Okay. Now, this I told you how to do the zero balancing in the split beam. And what happens if you have only single beam spectrophotometer? Then you put the sample over here. See, only one sample only one qubit is used. Okay, so all other architectures, they remain the same. The only variable which you will be getting is because of this qubit, and it may also absorb something, some radiations. So what you do, you take your reference liquid. Reference liquid means the solvent in which you are dissolving the analytes, that is your reference liquid. You take the reference liquid initially and then you go for zero calibration or you go for zero balancing. Okay, so once you have done this, your microcontroller at each and every wavelength, it will measure all these things, all the absorption at various wavelengths, and it will record it into its memory. And then when you will be measuring the samples, what it will be doing is that from those what you call recorded values, it will subtract the absorption levels at each of the at each of the wavelengths, and it will return you the subtracted values. Okay,
so do we need to check the values?
Pardon?
Sir, do we need to check the
Your voice is too low. I cannot hear you. Can anyone repeat what he said?
Sir, hello. I was asking that for that graph, absorption versus concentration, we have to check the R square value also. And if the R square value is low, then what we should do and what are the possible reasons?
Yeah, ask your volume if it is low. It is a very good question, in fact. So, can anyone tell me why you want to calculate R square value? Why you want to calculate R square value?
R square value is close to 1 or 0.9, then our like the graph we are getting, like it is the datas are fitting in that
Datas are fitting to what? See,
to
there are
the
two things.
equation.
Now, when you are telling that you want to model the thing, you are having one experimental data and one you are getting through this model. Okay, this is a linear model y equal to mx plus c. Now, through the r square value, you are determining how close these datas are, these model datas are to the experimental data. So it basically measures the closeness of the experimental and the experimental data and the measured data. Okay. So when R square is 1, we tell that it is having a very good correlation. Okay. Now, take an example, and we are telling the system that you have to do the linear modeling. Okay. Now, say for example, you want to go from point A to point B. There is a path. Okay? Point A to point B. It is a linear path. Now, if you fit the data over here through this linear point, you will be getting if you walk from point A to point B, and then I tell you, okay, you measure the distance by modeling. So at different points, you have gone from this point to say A1, then A2, then A3. And then I tell you have measured the distance. Now you fit this data. So it will be very, and if you do the modeling, you will be getting a very good fit. R square equals to 1. Okay. And suppose even if it is not 1, suppose there are some what you call measurement errors, you will be getting, if not 1, say R square equals to 0.99. Okay, it will be bit lower than 1, right? That's okay. But suppose there is a path from A to B and you have moved to A to B through this path, through this green path. Now, if I say you do the modeling, this linear modeling, and try to fit this data, then what you will do? Computer does not know, so it will try to fit the data over here. But the correlation what you will be getting, it will come down drastically. Are you getting my point? You will be getting a drastic reduction in the correlation coefficient. Now, so this is the reason why you get a reduction in the correlation coefficient. Now you asked why we should not take lower than this thing. So I think this answers my question. If there is a major deviation and if you are trying to fit a linear data, okay, then you will not get the thing, right? Say for example, over here only, in this case, where I was telling you the non-linearity, your senses is non-linear, sensor is getting non-linear, and you fit a straight line, computer will fit a straight line, but the R square will be reducing. So one of the reason for a reduced R square is the non-linearity of the sensors. Okay, non-linearity of the sensors is one of the thing. Second thing, Every time, have you used a UV visible spectrophotometer?
Yes, sir.
You have used. So how do you measure? You take the
Sir.
cuvette, you put your solution in the sample test one. You do not test the reference one, right? So in the sample test solution, you pour the data, pour the solution, test solution. You take a reading, then you take out and again do the take out the cuvette. You throw out the solution and again add up a solution in a fresh solution and then again do the measurement. Now, if during the handling, if you by chance touch the transparent part, what will happen? You will be incorporating some fats onto that, onto the window. So that would be increasing the absorbance of your sample. That can also result in the increased absorption. Okay, then if you have been using the UV spectrophotometer for a long period of time, there is a term called aging. The performance of your this, not only the source, your monochromators, your filters, they may become wavelength specific. Okay, so they may themselves, these optics within the spectrophotometer, they may also include some non-linearity during the measurement. Okay, I hope I am clear.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Now, what about over here? The same thing. It is when we are talking about this image processing based spectrophotometer. It is nothing but a single beam spectrophotometer. If you look the architecture of the single beam spectrophotometer, you have a light source, we have some optics, okay, then we have a solution, then we have a detector. Similarly, over here you have a source, the sample comes in over here, and then there is a detector, okay, and there is some optics. So it is following a single beam spectrophotometer architecture. It is similar to the single beam spectrophotometer architecture. So the measurement, it remains the same. So initially what you have to do, you have to measure the spectrum of the reference solvent, and then you have to keep it recorded in the memory. Then what you have to do while you are measuring the test, for the test you will be getting all this spectrum, right? Now from here you will be getting some values. So subtract the reference value from the test values what you are getting, and then you get this spectrum. Okay, you get this spectrum, right? Now herein, if you are making your own device, you have to be careful that you have to first calibrate your sensor, and the calibration of the sensor is done using a known light source, because a specific light source will give you a specific wavelength spectrum. Okay, yeah. So any question till now? No. Okay, good. Now let's go to the principle of the measurement. What we do, the principle of measurement using the UV visible spectrophotometer, it basically follows Beer-Lambert's law. So there are two laws, one is the Beer's law and the other is the Lambert's law. Beer's law, it says that the absorption is proportional to the concentration. Okay, and Lambert's law, it says that the path length of the sample, it is directly proportional to the absorption. Okay, and this eta, it is known as the molar absorptivity. In many cases you will find in many books it is written molar extinction coefficient. Okay, molar extinction coefficient. Now let's look into the Beer-Lambert's law. Let's derive the equation. So what we take is that minus of di by dx is directly proportional to the concentration and the intensity. So what is di by dx? Say for example, we are having this sample cuvette, okay, and through this we are passing an incident radiation, some of it getting absorbed within the solution, and we are getting a resultant transmitted radiation. Okay, now if I take this area and if I magnify over here, so what basically is happening, we can say, or we can break down this cell into a number of cells. Say this is a cell having a length of dx, then the next one, it is a cell, it is having a length of dx. Okay, so since it is absorbing, so what is happening, after each dx distance there is a reduction in the intensity, there is a reduction in the intensity, right? And that's why we introduce a negative term over here, and di by dx, negative di by dx means change in intensity with per unit change in the sample length. Okay, and say for example, the length of the cuvette, we call it as B. Okay, and this is nothing but, this is proportional to Ci, where C is the concentration of the solution and I is the intensity of the radiation. So if we change this proportionality and then we include the proportionality constant alpha over here, so what we have, and we take this minus sign to the other side, so we get di by dx is equal to minus of alpha ci, ci. Okay, and then if we go di by I, so this should be I. Okay, and then we take dx to the upper hand and this I we take it to the lower hand, we get di by I which is equal to minus of alpha c dx. Okay, then the next thing what we get, if we integrate both the sides, so we get integral of, we are getting I0 to I, initial is I0, final is I, so I0 to I di by I which is equals to minus of alpha c, and the variable over here is dx, integral of dx, what should be the limit at this point, starting point, when the I0 is entering into the cuvette, we call it the zero length, and when it is coming out of the cuvette, we, that distance is say b. So this total distance when the I0 is entering and getting out, it is the b, and we will consider the initial point when it is entering the cuvette as 0. So 0 to b dx. Okay, then we do the integration, we apply the limits I0 to I, and here 0 to b, then what we get, if we solve this one, natural log of I minus natural log of I0 which is equal to minus alpha cb. Okay, then this is nothing but log of natural log of I by I0 which is equal to minus alpha cb. Then if we take this minus into account over here, then we change this one and to natural log of I0 by I which is equal to alpha cb. Okay, then if you change this natural log to the log base 10, so it becomes 2.303 log base 10 I0 by I which is equal to alpha cb. Okay, now this alpha, if we calculate, it comes out to be 2.303 divided by bc multiplied by log 10 I0 by I. Okay, now this is similar to the first order kinetics. Here instead of bc we have time, with time it changes. So what happens, this means the absorption will change with respect to bc. Then this alpha by 2.303, if I take this one over here, which is equal to 1 by BC log 10 I 0 by I. So log 10 I 0 by I, which is equal to eta BC, where eta is equal to alpha by 2.303. Okay, and this eta, it is regarded as molar absorption coefficient or molar extension coefficient, and even it is regarded as molar absorptivity. Okay, so this eta BC, it is regarded as the absorption A. So our absorption A of the solution, it is given by log base 10 I0 by I, which is equal to epsilon BC. Okay, and this epsilon BC, it is basically the characteristics of the samples. Okay, characteristics of the samples, right? Now if you see over here, and also previously we have said that when we are making a radiation incident onto a sample, then some of the radiation is being absorbed within the sample. So that absorption, how much absorption has taken place, we have calculated this one. But some amount of radiation is also transmitted through the samples. Now that is being calculated through the transmittance, okay, by calculating the transmittance. And this transmittance is given by T equals to I by I0, okay. Then log base 10 T, if you take the logarithm at both the ends, we get log base 10 T equals to log 10 I by I0, okay. Then if I take this I0 up and I down, and I will be getting log 10 I0 by I, and since I have changed the numerator and the denominator, there will be a negative sign. So what is this log base 10 I0 by I? It is nothing but absorption. So log 10 T is equal to minus of absorption. Okay, now if you get rid of this log 10, then you get T equals to 10 to the power minus A, which is equals to 10 to the power minus epsilon BC, okay, molar absorption coefficient BC. Also, we know that T is equal to I by I0. If I want to find out the percent transmission, because that would give us an idea which we can easily find out. If I say that 60% of the transmittance is 60%, that means if I radiate a monochromatic radiation with 100 photons, then what will happen? 60% or the 60 photons will be passing through the sample, and 40 photons will be absorbed by the system. Okay, so it helps us in in easy understanding how many or how much percentage of photons are being absorbed and how much photons are being or getting transmitted from the system, right? So percent T, it is given by I0 multiplied by 100. So I by I0 is equal to percent T by 100. Okay, now from 1, that means log 10 T, which is equal to minus 1, we can say A equals to minus of log 10 T. So A is equals to minus of log 10 I by I0. Now I by I0, we replace it over here. So it becomes A equals to minus of log 10 percent T by 100. Okay, then A is equal to minus of log 10 percent T minus log 10 100. So A equals to minus of log 10 percent T plus 2. So finally we get absorption is equal to 2 minus log 10 percent transmission. Okay, so there are three equations over here which you should remember. The first one is the A equals to log 10 I0 by I, which is equal to epsilon bc. Then second we have this thing, log 10t is equal to minus of a, okay, and then lastly you have absorption equals to 2 minus log 10 percent transmittance. Okay, so say for example if I give the absorption of a particular liquid is 1, okay, so find out the percent transmittance of the solution. Then what you have to do, you have to put this 1 over here and then you have to solve this equation. If I say find out the transmittance of the solution, then you have to use this equation. Okay, are you getting my point? So if I say that I0 and I is this this much, so what is the absorption coefficient, what is the absorption of the solution, then you have to apply this formula. So you need to have an understanding of these three, one, these two, and these three. Three equations you should be remembering by heart. Okay, and also look into the okay. Again, another important thing, in many of the cases I have asked the students to tell me which law is directly give you an information about the correlation of the absorption with the concentration. They forget it, okay, they are not able to tell. So Beer's law, it gives you information about the concentration, relationship of the absorption and the concentration of the liquid or the sample. And Lambert's law, it relates the path length to the absorption of the samples. Okay, so with this we complete this chapter. If you have any question, I will be happy to answer those. No one is having any questions? Okay, good. So please remember, we started with this UV visible spectrophotometer, and this is an absorption spectroscopy. Okay, in absorption spectroscopy, basically we have a radiation source, okay, then we have monochromators, we have collimators or the optics. Okay, we have the optics which will make the radiation incident onto the collimator and all these things. Okay, so this is collimator. So after the collimator, we have the gratings. We have the gratings. So which helps us okay, which will convert the polychromatic light to monochromatic light. Okay, so in front of that you will be having an entrance slit. Okay, then you will be having a sample, then you may have an exit slit also. In many cases the grating itself, it will be having some entrance slit and exit slit. Okay, then we will be having a detector. Okay, so this is the what you call architecture, what you will be having. You will be having source, you will be having the optics. Okay, different optics, if I call these as optics, you will be having the optics, and then you will be having the sample. then we will be having the detector. Okay, so it will be in the same line. So this is the property, or what you call the generalized, what you call architecture of any absorption spectrometer. This is an absorption spectrometer. Okay, so this is how it goes. So please have this concept clear. For any absorption spectrometer, this is the architecture. If you remember this, every other spectral instrument what we will be discussing, it will be just like a cakewalk for you. Okay, anything you would like to ask?
Sir, in one type there was four sample and four for the different type, and in one only one type of sample, and we will be replacing it with the blank. So which type of will be the best for the measuring?
Which type is best? That's also a very good question. You are having this single beam spectrophotometer, and you are having this double beam split beam spectrophotometer. So in the single beam, if you see, the number of optics are quite low. So it is a low cost spectrophotometer, right? Over here, the number of optical stuffs, it has increased quite significantly. Now, since it has increased significantly, that means its cost will be very high. But still people are using this. Why? The reason is that, suppose if you are scanning in a UV region, say at a particular wavelength, say lambda 1, okay. Now when you are measuring, suppose there is some voltage fluctuation or some fluctuation within the lamp itself, what will happen? The amount of radiation what you will be getting in the sample and in the reference will be same, and at the output you will be getting a differential output. So okay, so suppose you are having 198, okay, the differential output will be 2. Suppose there is a fluctuation and you get the original reference one, it becomes 94. Accordingly, your lower one, it will become 92 also due to the fluctuation. Over here also you will get 2. So in the split beam spectrophotometer, you will be having an having a differential output which is proportional to the your what you call absorption, right? So if there are certain changes over here, and at all the time you are having the reference within the spectrophotometer, and there is a continuous dynamic dynamic comparison between the reference and the sample, this one is better. In the previous case, in this single beam spectrophotometer, suppose you have referenced it and you have made it zero, very good. And then you are measuring the other samples, that's also good. But what happens if there is any fluctuation? So initially you have set this one considering that you are having the incident radiation, 100 photons are falling on the system. But if there is a fluctuation, it may have, say, in the previous case we had 94 photons. Now the percentage absorption or the percentage transmitters, you will be calculating with respect to the 100, not with respect to the 94. So this is one of the disadvantages of the single beam spectrophotometer, and all the research grade spectrophotometer, they are usually split beam spectrophotometer, or many a cases they are also regarded as double beam spectrophotometer. Okay, because you are having two beams of light.
Okay, sir.
Anything else?
Yes, sir. No, sir.
Okay.